I contemplated in after last week whether I was going to be done with the prodigal son or not, and I'm not. We gave both of the boys 2 weeks, so it's only fitting that we give the father 2, although we're not comparing, are we? No, we're learning about that. But anyway, we've been on this journey 5 weeks now, and this is actually our 6th week, studying this parable. The parable is found in Luke chapter 15, verse 11 to 32. And so I'm not going to go back and repeat some of the scripture verses, but you have them there in front of you as a reference. But from the beginning that we've been prepared, I think, as we've read this story, to accept not only the younger son as an example, but also the elder son, and to see how this sort of revealed a little bit about our own spiritual journey. You know, for some of us, you know, we can easily identify with the rebellious son that left home. Or maybe if we haven't identified so much with him, we can identify with the resentment of the brother that stayed home. You know, there's aspects, I think, that we can see all along. But for a long time, we've sort of seen the father as the other character in the story, the one who receives us, the one that forgives us, and the one that offers us a home, the one that gives us the peace and the joy when we come to him. The Father is the place that we return to after we've gone our own way. It seems to be the goal of our journey is to enter into a final resting place with the Father. But has it ever occurred to you that our spiritual journey is not complete as long as the Father remains an outsider? That if God, who remains somewhat threatening and somewhat fearsome, is our spiritual formation hindered if we think of him that way? If what we learn about the Father's love enables us to go beyond just the fact that he has authority over us or has some power over us, that we have to do whatever is according to his will. But maybe we've been limited by our fear of God's power. And it seems wise to remain maybe just a little bit of a careful distance from him, even though there's something in us that wants to get closer. I remember preaching a message about Peter. I think you kind of referred to that this morning in prayer, you know, that the confounding Christ. How when Jesus did that great miracle in Peter's boat, you know, where he had fished all night with nothing, and then he receives this great load of fish. How he wanted to embrace the Lord, and at the same time he wanted to push him away because he recognized his own sinfulness. And it seems that for many, that the fear of becoming subject to God's revenge and punishment sort of has paralyzed their mental and emotional lives independently of their age, independent of their lifestyle. And this paralyzing fear of God is one of the great human tragedies in our lives. It seems that through this story that we read here, we're to let go of all fear of the Father. And it becomes possible actually to become like the Father. I hope you don't read in what I've been saying about there's no responsibility, there's no repentance on our part. You know, that would be to say that anybody goes to God and every one of us leads to heaven. There obviously is a response that we have to have, amen? You know, but as long as the Father evokes fear, he remains an outsider, and he can't dwell within us. And the reality is that our final vocation, though, is really to become like the Father and to live out his divine compassion in our daily lives. We are like, obviously, the younger or the elder son. But the reality is this, is we're not supposed to remain like them. We are called to become like the Father. There's no mother or father that's ever become a mother or father without first being a son or a daughter. But every son or daughter has to consciously choose to step beyond their childhood and become the father and the mother for others. I know it's a hard and lonely step to take, especially in a period of history where parenting is so hard to live out. But it's a step that's essential for the fulfillment of our spiritual journey. God is asking us to mature, to take on a role and a responsibility in our lives. And we need to make the father the center of our attention, not just the two boys. And it seems much easier to identify with the two sons. You know, the outer waywardness, the inner waywardness. We can understand that. It's human. It's something we can identify with. It happens almost spontaneously as soon as the connections are pointed out. And maybe you've identified more with one son or the other. And all of us at some point participate to a greater or lesser degree in all the forms of human brokenness in our lives. Neither greed nor anger, neither lust nor resentment, neither frivolity or jealousy are completely absent from any one of us. Our human brokenness can be acted out in many ways. But there's no offense, there's no crime or war that doesn't have its seed in our own human heart. But you say, well, what about the father? Why pay attention to the sons when it's the father who is in the center? When it's the father with whom we are to identify with? You know, why talk so much about being like the sons when the real question is this: are we interested in becoming like the father? It feels good maybe for us to say, well, these sons are like us. It gives us a sense of being understood. But how does it feel to say the father is like us? Or I should rephrase the question, do we want to be like the Father? Do we want to be not just the one who's being welcomed home, but also the one that welcomes others home? Not just the one that receives the compassion, but the one that is willing to give compassion. Isn't there sort of a subtle pressure in our churches and society to remain like a dependent child? I mean, hasn't the church, in a sense, in the past, stressed obedience in a fashion that made it hard to even claim spiritual fatherhood? Hasn't our consumer society encouraged us to indulge in childish, selfish gratification? Who has truly liberated ourselves from this immature dependencies to actually accept the burden of the responsibility of becoming an adult? And aren't we somehow constantly trying to escape the fearful task of fatherhood? Maybe one of the most radical statements Jesus ever made was in Luke 6:36. He says, be compassionate as your father is compassionate. And God's compassion is described by Jesus not simply to show us how willing God is to feel us or to forgive us our sins or to offer us new life and happiness, but actually to invite us to become like him, to show the same compassion to others that he is showing to us. I think for us to really get an idea of how we're to reach our community, we really have to understand what we've been going through as we've been going through this prodigal son story. If the only meaning of the story were that people sin and God forgives, we could easily begin to think of our sins as a fine occasion for God to show us his forgiveness. It wouldn't really be much challenge if we were interpreting the story this way. And we would resign ourselves to our own weakness and keep hoping that eventually God will close his eyes somehow, let us come home, whatever we do. But this is sentimental, being romantic. It's not what the message of the Gospels is all about. We're called to make true is that whether you are the younger or the elder son, you are the son of a compassionate father. Amen. And we are an heir. It says in Romans 8, verse 16 and 17, that no one says it more clearly, I think, than what the Apostle Paul writes here. He says, the Spirit joins with our spirit to bear witness that we are all children of God. And if we are children, then we are heirs. Not H-A-I-R-S, H-E-I-R-S, just in case you don't understand my diction. You know, we have something that God's given us. We have an inheritance. We are heirs of God. We are joint heirs with Christ. We have provided that we share his sufferings so as we can share his glory. Amen. As a son, I use the word daughter as well. The Bible speaks to sons, but it's sons and daughters. As God's children, we are heirs and we become successors. We're destined to step into the Father's place and offer to others the same compassion that he's offered to us. And the return to the Father is ultimately the challenge to become the Father. I'm not saying you become gods. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm trying to say that God wants to shape us so that we resemble him. Amen. So that we are grown up. The call is to become the Father. It precludes any kind of soft interpretation of this story. We know how much we long to return. We know how much we want to be held safe. But do we really want to be a son and an heir with all that that implies? Because being in the Father's house requires that we make the Father's life our life. So it requires being transformed in his image. I don't know if you ever look in the mirror and you wonder who the old guy is that's looking back at you. Because if you're a woman, that'd be a bad thing to see an old guy looking at you. But you wonder, how did that person get there? And maybe even you look at the mirror and you see and you say, what's my father doing in the mirror? Maybe you've got a glimpse of your mother or your father as you look into the mirror as you're aging, and many of your questions of who you are and who you are to become is being shaped by being a son or daughter of your mother and father. Now, when you look at the story of the prodigal son, it makes us understand that we can no longer use our sonship or our daughtership to keep us at a distance. You know, having lived our sonship to the fullest, we can't keep pointing to our father as an excuse for our life. We have to dare to stretch out our own hands, a blessing. To receive with ultimate compassion our own children, regardless of how they feel or think about us. And since becoming the compassionate father is the ultimate goal of our spiritual life, it is expressed in this parable, we need to explore what does this really mean? What is the significance of what Jesus is teaching us here? First of all, we have to keep in mind the context which Jesus is telling the story, that this man who had two sons. You know, you read in the first two verses of Luke chapter 15, he writes, the tax collectors and sinners, they were all crowding around to listen to Jesus, and the Pharisees and the scribes were complaining, saying, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. It's interesting that in comparison to that, the tax collectors and sinners drew near to him to hear him. But they were putting Jesus' legitimacy as a teacher in question by criticizing how close he was to sinful people. And in response, Jesus tells his critics the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, the parable of the lost son. Because Jesus wants to make it clear that the God of whom he speaks is a God of compassion who joyously welcomes repentant sinners into his house. So to associate and eat with people of ill repute, therefore, doesn't contradict his teaching about God. But it does, in fact, live out this teaching in an everyday life. If God forgives sinners, then certainly those who have faith in God should do the same. If God welcomes sinners home, then certainly those who trust in God should do likewise. If God is compassionate, then certainly those who love God should be compassionate as well. The God whom Jesus announces and in whose name he acts is the God of compassion, the God who offers himself as an example and a model for all of us. But there's more. Becoming like the Heavenly Father, it's not just one important aspect of Jesus' teaching. It's the very heart of his message. The radical quality of Jesus' words and the seemingly impossible demands are quite obvious when heard as part of a general call to become sons and daughters of the Most High God. And as long as we belong to this world, we will remain subject to its competitive ways and expect to be rewarded for all the good we do. We have this tension within us. We belong to God who loves us without condition, and we can live as he does. That's what he's calling us to do. And the great conversion called for by Jesus is to move from belonging to this world to belonging to his Father's world. Shortly before his death, Jesus prayed to his Father for his disciples. And I'll just grab a few verses out of that. But John 17, verse 16 to 21, his prayer. But Jesus was praying things like this: Father, they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. May they be one. Just as, Father, you are in me and I am in you, so they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that it was you who sent me. Once we're in God's house as sons and daughters of his household, here's the good news. We can be like him. We can love like him. We can be good like him. We can care like him. You know, Jesus leaves no doubt in this parable. In Luke chapter 6, verse 32 to 36, he says, if you love those who love you, what credit can you expect? Even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit can you expect? For even sinners do that. And if you lend to those with whom you hope to get your money back, what credit can you receive? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. Instead, he says, love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend without hope of return, and you will have great reward, and you will be children of the Most High, for he himself is kind to the ungrateful and to the wicked. Be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. This is the core message of the gospel, isn't it? I mean, the way that we are called to love one another is God's way. We're called to love one another with the same selfless, outgoing love. The compassion with which we are to love can't be based on a competitive lifestyle. It has to be absolute compassion, where we don't find this trace of competition. It has to do with a radical love for our enemy, didn't say our friends. And if we're not only to be received by God, that's not what our whole aim is, but it's also to receive others as God. So we must become like our Heavenly Father and see the world through His eyes. I know this is challenging for us. I know there's personal issues that we have in some of our families, whether it's prodigal sons or daughters or just people that have hurt us in the past. And you know, we're wanting to be reconciled, but we also are sort of holding the cards in regards to that. It's more important than the context of the parable. The explicit teaching of Jesus here, we find it is the Father is found in the person of Christ Himself. Because Jesus is the true Son of the Father. And He's the model that we have to become like the Father. Because the Bible says that in Christ the fullness of the Godhead dwells. All knowledge of God resides in Jesus. All the glory of God remains in Him. And all the power of God belongs to Him. And His union with the Father is so intimate, so complete, that to see Jesus is to see the Father. That's what He told Philip. In John 14:9, Philip says to Jesus, "Show us the Father." And Jesus responds, "Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." See, Jesus shows us what it really means to be a true son. He's the younger son without being rebellious. He's the elder son without being resentful. In everything, He's the obedient to the Father, but He's never His Father's slave. He hears everything the Father says, but He does not make Him His servant. He does everything the Father sent Him to do, but He remains completely free. He gives everything, and He receives everything. And He says in John 5, verse 19 to 23, He openly declares this, "In all truth I tell you, by Himself the Son can do nothing." And He can only do what He sees the Father doing, and whatever the Father does, the Son does too. For the Father loves the Son. He shows Him everything He Himself does, and He will show Him even greater things than these works, that will astonish you. Thus, as the Father raises the dead, gives them life, so the Son gives life to anyone He chooses. For the Father judges no one. He has entrusted all judgment to the Son, so that all may honor the Son as they honor the Father. Yeah, as Pastor Delsa mentioned last night, I was asked to preach. It probably couldn't have been at a worse time for me, or maybe it was the best time for me, I don't know. I've been just like really up to here with stuff this week, and even Friday, I think it was 6 o'clock before I left the office, I still wanted to do a hospital visitation. My wife did the hospital visitation for me because it just was so many things, and then, you know, I was waiting and getting reports done, and I still was Saturday afternoon trying to finish this message. But I realized, you know, one of the things, and Pastor Andrew's been teaching, you know, experiencing God in our Bible study, and one of the thoughts is that you're a tool. God's the one that wants to work His work through you. See, it's not you doing God's work, it's God doing His work through you. Amen. And so I obviously couldn't preach this message, nor did I have my iPad anyway. I couldn't preach the message that I had prepared for the memorial service this afternoon because that wasn't appropriate either. So at 7 o'clock, after we're praying, I'm asking, "Lord, what is it you want me to speak tonight?" But you know what? There's something freeing about that because then it's His message that He speaks. Amen? And in the very thought that He had dropped that I had shared in our Bible study on Monday night became the message that got to be preached last night. Jesus is divine sonship. It is to His sonship that we are called. The mystery of redemption is that God's Son became flesh so that every single one of his children, those that would come to him, those that repent of their sin, could become the sons and daughters of God, just like Jesus, as his son. And this perspective, the prodigal son story, takes on a whole new dimension when you begin looking at the Father and us becoming the Father. Because Jesus, the beloved of the Father, leaves his Father's home to take on the sins of God's wayward children and bring them home. But while leaving, he stays close to the Father. And through total obedience, he offers healing to even his resentful brothers and sisters. And thus, for our sake, Jesus becomes the younger brother son, as well as the elder son, in order to show us how to become like the Father. And through him, we can become true sons, and we can grow to become compassionate as our Heavenly Father is. I think as the years of our lives pass, we can discover how challenging this is. And at the same time, it can be fulfilling as we grow into spiritual fatherhood. I hope those of you that are ladies are understanding, you know, that you also can grow in fatherhood. You know, the idea of who our Father is, whether it's fatherhood, motherhood, whatever you want to call it, the fact is that we can grow into becoming like our Father. Even in our best intentions, we still find ourselves trying to acquire some kind of power. Yeah, when you give advice, you want to know that that advice is being followed. When you offer help, you want to be thanked for the help that you gave. When you give money, you want somebody to use the money the way you intended it to be used. When you do something good, you want somebody else to remember you for doing what you did good. But the father of the prodigal son's not concerned about himself. His long-suffering life was emptied him of his desire to keep control of things. The only concern he has is for his children. He wants to give himself completely for them. For them, he wants to pour out what he has completely. As I reflect on the story of the prodigal son, I think there are three ways to compassionate fatherhood. Three ideas. I'll give them to you. Grief, forgiveness, and generosity. It might seem strange to consider grief as a way to compassion, but it really is. Because grief asks us to allow the sins of the world, including our own, to pierce our hearts, to make us shed tears. I don't think you can have compassion without shedding tears. If it's not tears that stream out of your eyes, then surely they're tears that need to come from your heart. When you consider the waywardness of God's children, you know, all of us included, our lust, our greed, our violence, our anger, our resentment, you know, we look at them through the eyes, look at these things through the eyes of God's heart. You can't but weep and cry out in grief. And grief is like a discipline of our heart that sees the sins of the world and knows itself to be a sorrowful price of freedom without love. Without this, love can't bloom. In other words, God has to give us a choice, doesn't he? If we're really going to choose to love him. And he recognizes what it means when you go your own way. He knows what the hurt is. It hurts him to see you hurting. It hurts him to see the destruction in our lives. You know, much prayer, I think, is grieving. We're grieving over the sin of our family. We're grieving over the sin of our cities. We're grieving over the sin of our nation. Somebody just sent me a news this week about a bill that's trying to be sponsored in Massachusetts. And at this point, there's no limit, really, to a young girl wanting to have an abortion. However, there needs to be a parental notification. And now they want to remove that away. So a 12, 13-year-old girl can make this decision without her parents ever having known this. How is this helping the child? There's a grief that needs to grow within us as we understand the things around us. And to become like the Father, His only authority that He places over us is the compassion. We have to shed tears to prepare our hearts to receive someone that would come back, to whatever the journey they've been on, and to be able to forgive them from our heart. And that's the second way that leads to fatherhood or spiritual fatherhood, is forgiveness. It's through constant forgiveness that we become like the Father. And let's be honest, forgiveness is difficult. It's very difficult. It's even, you could say, next to impossible for us. Jesus said to His disciples in Luke 17:4, when your brother wrongs you seven times a day, and seven times comes back to you and says, I'm sorry, you must forgive him. I mean, if we had a brother that sinned against us one time a day for 7 days, that would be difficult. If he sinned against us one time for 7 months. Look, we might have told others, I forgive you. But even as we say these words, our heart remains angry, and we can remain resentful. We'd rather hear that we were right all along. We want to hear apologies. We want to hear excuses. We want to get satisfaction for receiving some kind of praise in return, if only the praise is for being so forgiving. But God's forgiveness is unconditional. It comes from a heart that doesn't demand anything for itself, a heart that's completely emptied of self-seeking. It's a divine forgiveness that we have to practice in our daily life. It calls us to kind of step over the need for your own gratification and compliments. And it demands of us that we sort of step over that wounded part of our heart that feels hurt and wronged and wants to stay in control, and put a few conditions between us and the person that we're being asked to forgive. Grief allows us to see beyond our wall and realizes the immense suffering that results from human losses. We can see the pain that a person went through because of the journey that they've been on. Yeah, I know you've been on a pain too through that journey. And that's the difference between being the son or being the father. There is a pain, but it opens your heart to the general or genuine solidarity with other human fellows. You understand what it means to walk in this way. And forgiveness is the way to step over the wall and welcome others into your heart without expecting something in return. It's not like I'm going to forgive him, but may not Dan do this again to me. So we have grief, forgiveness, and a third way that leads to us in spiritual fatherhood is generosity. When you read the parable of the prodigal son, the father keeps nothing for himself. You remember the beginning of the story. The father was demanded of him that he separate his inheritance. Well, the younger boy got everything that the father had. He gave it to him based on the inheritance laws. The older brother got everything that the father had for him. And even though we look at that, we recognize that the prodigal son's father kept nothing for himself. He poured it out on his sons. And he doesn't simply offer them more than he can reasonably expect it from someone who has been offended. No, he completely gives himself away without reserve. To him, both sons are everything. And in them, he wants to pour out his very life. Even the way the younger son is given a robe a ring, sandals, welcomed home with this great celebration, as well as the eldest son, who's urged to accept his unique place in his father's heart, to join his younger brother around the table, make it clear that all boundaries of this fatherhood behavior are broken, where he's not demanding and controlling over their lives. This is a portrayal of God, whose goodness, love, forgiveness, care, joy, and compassion, they have no limits. We're having a hard time hearing this. Maybe it's because we really don't want to do this. Jesus presents God's generosity by using all the imagery that the culture provides while constantly transforming it. In order to be like the Father, he's saying we need to be generous as the Father is generous. Just as the Father gives his very self to his children, we must give our very self to our brothers and sisters. Jesus makes it very clear that it's precisely this giving of self that's the mark of a true disciple. No one can have greater love than to lay down his life for his friends, Jesus said. Grief, forgiveness, and generosity. These are three ways in which the image of the Father can grow in us. There are three aspects of the Father's call to be home. As the Father, we can no longer call to come home like the younger or elder son, but to be the one to whom all other wayward children can return and welcome with joy. It's very hard to just be home and wait, isn't it? And it's in waiting in grief for those who have left and waiting with hope to offer forgiveness and new life to those who return. Just as the Father, we have to believe that all that the human heart desires can be found home. And as the Father, we have to be free from the need to wander around curiously to catch up with things that we might otherwise perceive as missed childhood opportunities. Always looking for love in all the wrong places. And as the Father, we know that indeed our youth is over. The playing youthful games is nothing but ridiculous attempt to cover up the truth that you know what the reality is? You're old and you're getting older and soon you're going to die. As the Father, we have to dare to carry the responsibility of spiritual adult people and dare to trust that the real joy and the real fulfillment can only come when we welcome home those who have been hurt and wounded on their journey of life. And somehow, by God's grace, loving them with a love that doesn't ask for anything in return. It's becoming like the Father that will make our evangelism work. It's becoming like the Father that will allow us to receive the prodigals back into our midst. It's becoming like the Father that we have to deal with our childish ways and ask God to help us to overcome our own need for acceptance, our own need for control, our own need for justification. And as we give this to him and he raises us up, all that we need is found in him. It says in 2 Corinthians, let me find this, chapter 5. If anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Verse 17. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Amen. As we understand our role, and that's why I've included this idea of grief. Yes, there's some grief that we must go through. There's some heartache that we must identify with, so that we can identify with our Father, who also has a heartache for us to come home, to be with him. As we understand this, may we come to the reality that God wants us to sort of step over this wall of all these issues that we have. I understand there's loneliness when you climb over that wall, because you're not looking for something for you. You're looking for something for others. And it means emptying yourself completely, just as Jesus did, to give without having something given back. I wish I could tell you I was there. I'm not there. God's still working things in me, as he needs to work in all of us. That's part of the maturing process. But there's a difference becoming a father than simply being a child. I thank God that we're always his children. But he wants us to be heirs, to walk in his plan, to represent him, to do the work that he wants to do through us, if we allow him to work through these issues. And I think maybe all of us have some of those issues, and we need to bring them before the Lord and say, Lord, I don't need to be justified. I don't need to be recognized. I don't need to, you know, have all these things. You are my justification. You are the one that provides all that I need. All I need to do is receive your love. And if I do that, I can give greater to others around me. Help us, Lord, be people that are maturing into fatherhood, so that we might be able to embrace many wayward sons and daughters in the days ahead, and to really love them, recognizing the pain of the journey they've been on, but also teaching them your unconditional love. We ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Lord, we just come before you. You are mighty and you are great. Let your peace follow us. And Lord, even as we prepare for this afternoon, let your presence be strong so that we might be able to articulate through our own lives and through the words we use your greatness, the fact that you are always with us, and that you are sufficient for anything that we go through. We just want to bless you. Bless the congregation as we go from this place. In Jesus' name, amen.